we are live, and this is kind of an unexpected show. I'm not going to be talking about, you know, Mutiny on the Bounty. That was Julia's topic, and Julia has a situation right now that she has to handle, and she won't be able to be here. So instead of that, I thought I would help to review this book that I got, which is from the TV program, It's Okay Not to Be Okay. I can show you a clip of Bo opening the book, and then we can talk about it some more. There was a kind of a shrink wrap on top of the book.
Yeah,
but wanted to remove that. Okay, and then we removed the shrink wrap. And this is Bo looking at the book. Pardon me while I go get myself some water to drink.
No, אנחנו חותכים את זה עכשיו.
Okay, all right. All right, so what's this all about? Well, I don't know if you remember that Julia and I reviewed the Korean show, It's Okay Not to Be Okay, a few years back, and it was a very good show, and we both enjoyed it very much. And it dealt with some interesting issues of mental health and what to do about adult children. Who have difficulties and who might need help. So I don't really read Korean, but here's what I remember of the story. There was a mother, and she loved her daughter very, very much. And she said she would do anything for her daughter. And she tried to make her daughter's life as wonderful as possible. She would feed her daughter, and she didn't allow her daughter to feed herself, and her daughter kind of became very dependent. And then eventually, when the mother was sick, the daughter couldn't take care of her, and the mother realized that the daughter was just this big empty mouth and was a burden to her. And so she threw her daughter like a fish into the sea. And every once in a while, sailors will pick up the child who is basically a head and a mouth. Okay, So what's the point of this story? It's actually a very dark story. The question is, what happens when there are adult children that cannot take care of themselves? Things don't always turn out well. We have whole generations of autistic, low functioning autistic children who become adults and who's going to take care of them. There are whole generations of people who have various mental illnesses, such as schizophrenia, and who's going to take care of them. And different states have different policies on this, but the one thing that they don't seem to have figured out is the family relationships, the rights of the parents, the duties of the parents after someone is an adult and not able to take care of themselves. And the other thing is the whole idea that if you happen to be a human being, you should be free, even if you can't take care of yourself. So there are states in which there are a lot of homeless people who wander around, and many of them, you could say it's not their fault exactly. It's not within their capability to take care of themselves. But because the state has decided that they are free and they will continue to be free no matter what they do, unless they really, really harm another person in a very bad way, then these people are just wandering around. They don't have any parents to take care of them. They don't have any guardians to take care of them. The state's not going to take care of them either. Now, there are other states that have other policies that are kind of the other way, where the moment it becomes clear that somebody happens to be psychotic, even for a moment, that person will immediately be locked up in a psych ward. And even if their family wants to help them and wants to take them home, the state will actually fight you. So there are these different spectrums of what's going on. And what does this have to do with Bo? Well, the thing is, you might be wondering why I'm here, why Bo is here, and why Bo isn't free to go anywhere he likes, if he's an intelligent being. Well, many of these human beings are very intelligent. They have a high IQ, but that doesn't mean they can take care of themselves, because that's not all that goes into it. In the past, families would take care of their own and would even make sure that they had facilities in their home to, instead of sending a child away to an institution, they could keep them at home, take care of them at home, and know the child didn't have the right to roam freely, especially when they were in a phase of their life when they couldn't take care of themselves. So the idea was freedom was given to those who were capable of the responsibility that comes with it. And I think that's a good idea. And I think it's wrong that we discarded it. Between me and Bo, we have a loving relationship. I raised him. Things did not exactly turn out the way I thought they would. I did not think that at this point in my life, in my old age, I would be raising Bo still in my home. There were a lot of things that we hoped would happen, where we could join a research team and he could join other chimps and I could join other researchers. But the one thing I always promised him is that I was not going to, walk out on him. And I'm not going to. But at the same time, in order to keep him safe and to keep me safe, it is not possible for him to have complete freedom and to wander around anywhere. And I think that if parents of adult children had the same attitude toward their children that I have toward Bo, that this would be a better world and we would be able to take care of all of our children, including the ones that cannot take care of themselves. So, you know, that's my public servant announcement. But I really think that our society has completely lost sight of what freedom is for, who gets to have freedom. The fact that freedom is not all based on intelligence or being a human being. It's about your ability to make decisions for yourself. And as long as we don't know this about human beings, we're not going to understand this about chimpanzees as well. So that's my feeling on the topic. I know that this is not the scheduled programming that you were expecting. I had very short notice to prepare this. If there's anybody out there watching this who would like to ask some questions or participate in a discussion, that would be great. Otherwise, I might resort to telling you about my books, which are different from the It's Okay Not to Be Okay book. Okay? Because here's the thing. I'm not just a researcher. I'm not just a teacher. I'm not just a linguist. I'm also a writer. And while I've kind of had to accept that my writing is not necessarily everybody's cup of tea, I still hope to get people interested in it. And so I will share some of my writing with you. This is In Case There's a Box, and it's written in two languages. Now, I've had other people read it for me, and other people are better readers than I am, because being a good writer and being a good reader are two different things. But while my voice lasts, I can read it to you and show it to you. When Sword goes for walks in the fields full of flocks, she is always concerned that she might meet a fox. So when Sword makes her rounds, inspecting the grounds, then along for the stroll comes her trusty bloodhound. See the picture of the bloodhound? And the pair take great care to question each air goes bounding by. Any foxes out there? But they never reply as they go bounding by. And Sword and her hound are not certain why. Could it be that the hares are entirely too scared to snitch on the fox who is lingering there? Or perhaps they won't talk for fear that the shock of being discovered might injure the fox. Is it out of concern that the trust that they've earned with the fox all these years might never return? Be that as it may, the hares never say one single word as they all bound away. But Sword has a plan, which she'll use if she can, of how to appeal to the fox and his clan. A canvas and paints is a method most quaint to chisel away at fox self-restraint. Come out just a bit. Oh, please come and sit for a portrait of you and your wife and your kids. And so now and then, Sword calls out again, come, I'll paint you a picture to hang in your den. But no one comes out, though she yells and she shouts. Is there really a fox? The hounds start to doubt. But Sword is not swayed by the hound's doleful bay or the absence of tracks day after day. As a sun starts to set, Sword never regrets the foxes she's hunted each day without let. And next day at sunrise, Sword will open her eyes, glad of the light in the spacious blue skies. And along on her walks, she will lug her paint box, which will really come handy in case there's a fox. Okay, do you want to hear it in Hebrew? Demikre shel shual. Kshecherev yotzet lasade shtufatal. Tamid yesh sikui shetifkosh beshual. Lachen kshiyotzeti kol yom min habayit leyada letzida mehalech kelev tzayid. Kol arnav o shafan shepogeshet tishal. Haim bemikre ra'ita shual. אך אין השפנים נענים לה בכלל, ולא מזכירים את סודות השואל. האם ייתכן שכל זאת בגלל הברית שקראת כל שפן עם שואל? כמובן השפן ייתכן שנבהל מפני החשש שינקום בו שואל. או האם זה משום שחבל לשפן להסגיר את שכנו? כי הוא קודם אמן. הסיבה לא ברורה, אך בעצם לא קל לגרום לשפן להלשין על שואל. אך חרב רוצה במרמה או מזל לגלות בעצמה את סודות השואל. כל ערב חוזרת עייפה אל הבית, כל בוקר יוצאת בלוויית כלב צייד. אדוני השואל, בוא תראה באמת. יש לי צבע מכחול לצייר כאן פורטרט. אותך, אשתך וגם הגורים, הצייר כקישוט לחדר מגורים. את קולה מרימה, אך תמיד אין מזל, רק שקט, דממה מצד השואל. חרב לא מוותרת, צועקת בקול, אך כלב הצייד מתחיל כבר לשאול. מניין נודע לך שיש כאן שואל? אינני מריח, אין זכר בכלל. אין פה עקבות ואין שום סימן לשואל או זאב או אפילו לטעם. החרב אינה מוותרת בכלל. אני מאמינה שאומנם יש שואל. כל ערב חוזרת הביתה לישון, בבוקר יוצאתי לכל פעמון. נושאת כלי ציור ששמה בסל, ותמיד מוכנה במקרה של שואל. Okay, so this is not just an example of creative writing. It's not just an example of writing in two languages. It also scans and rhymes. It's poetry. And that's just one of my children's books. Obviously, one of my best known books is a book for adults, and it's called Vacuum County. And I'm wondering if it would be possible to share the actual trailer that we have for that. Let me see if I can do that a different way. So if I were to, I probably should have downloaded it before. So I'll just read you the back cover. The back cover says this. On his Texas Hill County ranch, Naval Cabeza de Vaca is master of all he surveys. But David Smith is running for county judge, and he has designs on Nabal's wife and his cattle and all that he owns. A familiar saga about taxation, lechery, and covetousness of biblical proportions. Okay. you're probably not getting what any of this has to do with anything else that I've talked about. But all of these books have libertarian values. I have libertarian values. I feel that people should take responsibility for their families, for their children, and that freedom is only for those who can take care of themselves. And the other thing is, when I make a promise that I'm going to be there for someone, even if it's inconvenient, and even if it's 20 years later, I'm still there for that someone. So I think that's how it should be. I think that this is how families should be for each other. This is why Beau and I are still living together in this house. And it's not because I wouldn't like to go other places. And it's not because I'm agoraphobic or can't get out of the house. It's because I have to take care of him. And that's a responsibility that I took on. And I'm not going to shirk my responsibility, even when it's not convenient. So, I mean, a lot of you imagine that, oh, it's grand. You get to be groomed by a chimpanzee, and the chimpanzee grooming videos are what it's all about. And no, that was never the goal. That's just something that happens to happen because, you know, he needs to groom someone so he can groom me. But it's not about this. And if you think that it is, you're misconstruing it. The other side of this is, of course, he communicates by pointing at letters and he can tell me what he wants. So he's literate. He's able to express himself. We can talk to each other, but that doesn't mean that he understands monetary theory or that he would know how to go and get a job and support himself. And these are all issues that I don't think people have worked out for other human beings, much less for themselves. I'm not going to prolong this. I really did expect Julia to be able to be here and, to tell us all about Mutiny on the Bounty. So anyway, that's what I had to share tonight. I didn't want to not have a live stream at all. I appreciate your coming on here. We just recently got to 70,000 subscribers on this channel, which is nothing to scoff at. I'm very grateful for that. And so what I'd like to do is I'd like to say goodnight, and I will talk to you guys again next Friday. Okay, bye-bye. Good night.